Fees must fall. Activist Kanya Cekeshe, a court appearance today. We showed you footage already this morning. Advocate Lugai Dobie there taking charge of the process. Let's go there live.
Applicant, pleaded guilty to charges. Subsequent to that plea of guilt, he submitted a document dated the 9th of January 2018. Purported to be an application under Section 309B of the Criminal Procedure Act, in terms of which he challenged both the conviction and the sentence. When we have gone through the record of the proceedings, we could not locate where the argument on conviction was. There are numerous difficulties with the record which I will address in this course. But for the current purposes, illustrate your worship that there was an attempt at appealing the attempt, applying for leave to appeal in relation to the conviction. But that seems to have been jettisoned or abandoned.
Because it does not appear to have been argued at the time of the application for leave to appeal. Certainly, when your worship gave judgment on the leave to appeal in relation to sentence, your worship made it clear that the application was confined to sentence. So insofar as our petition remains in the High Court and it also challenges conviction, that part that challenges the conviction is premature because I have to first get leave before your worship. So today I will be also asking your worship for leave to appeal in relation to conviction. If I can then go to the first application before your worship, which is the application for bail pending the appeal. I should first deal with the arguments that have been raised by our learned friends. And I'll do this shortly because they have raised three technical arguments, and I'll show your lordship that none of these technical arguments have any purchase. In the answering affidavit filed on behalf of the state, three arguments are made. The first argument that is made is that there was that there is no application by Mr. Cekeshe himself, and that the application has been deposed to by Mr. Stay, my attorney. It should be manifest that that objection has zero prospects, because Mr. Stay explains the circumstances in which he ended up signing the affidavit on behalf of Mr. Cekeshe. Mr. Cekeshe, we know, is currently incarcerated. Anyone who has ever attempted to visit a person who is in prison knows precisely the difficulties of mere access, let alone the difficulties of consultation and the difficulties of getting that person to depose to the affidavit. Mr. Stein has given chapter and verse of the circumstances in which he ended up deposing to the affidavit on behalf of Mr. Cekeshe. But nevertheless, Mr. Cekeshe has signed a power of attorney in which he explicitly instructs Mr. Stein to take all steps necessary to bring this application, to appeal against this application if it fails, and to bring an application for leave to appeal. And so, in the context where there is a full ventilation of the reasons why Mr. Stale signed the affidavit on behalf of Mr. Cekeshe, in circumstances where everybody knows that Mr. Cekeshe is currently an incarcerated man, and in circumstances where there is a power of attorney that authorizes my attorney, Mr. Stale, to sign this affidavit, the objection should simply be discarded. The second objection that has been taken by our learned friend is in paragraph 8 of their answering affidavit, where they argue that it would be premature for your lordship to decide the issue of bail before the petition in the High Court has been decided. Now, the problem here is that they get the law completely wrong. It is not the law that an applicant for bail subsequent to sentencing must first wait the outcome of the petition. The law is that as soon as the petition is lodged, you are entitled to ask for bail pending the outcome of that petition. The only question that a court will then examine is whether or not you have met the threshold requirement in order to be entitled to bail pending the outcome of the appeal. So objection number two, just like objection number one, has absolutely zero merit. Then the third objection is the issue of the conviction. But I've shown your lordship that we have in fact brought the application for leave to appeal in relation to the conviction. So insofar as that was an objection raised then, it no longer carries any weight at this point in time. When we turn to the merits of the application, this is what the state says in paragraph 15 of its answering affidavit. It says, it is submitted that the applicant was the person in that group of students who set the police vehicle on fire. Two police rifles, firearms, were burnt inside the police van. That is clear in his guilt plea. Now, I can take your lordship to the plea of guilt, and your lordship will see that there are no such admissions in the plea of guilt. There are no admissions that the applicant admitted that there were police firearms that were burnt inside the police van. That was the evidence that was led subsequent to the conviction for the purposes of sentencing. There is not a single line in the section 112.2 statement, and indeed in the record of the proceedings, that says that at the time the police vehicle was burnt, there were two police rifles and firearms. That evidence was led not for conviction. It was
the IMTT had
guilty because the state evidence was overwhelming against him. Now that is a conclusion of law, it takes us nowhere. Why they say it was overwhelming is then stated in the next sentence. They said real evidence, which was a video footage, was clear and showing the role the applicant played in the commission of the offenses. The applicant now seemingly wants his guilty plea to be changed to one of not guilty. So let's take the first part of that sentence where they say real evidence, which was a video footage, was clear and showing the role the applicant played in the commission of the offenses. The state faces two hurdles in relation to this. The first hurdle is that, as your lordship remembers, there was in fact no video evidence produced during the trial. I can show your lordship the docket in this case. It is in volume 2. Nevertheless, the full docket, we have examined the full docket. Where there is some sort of photographic evidence, there is not a single reference to video. Instead, there is a document signed by one of the police officers. It is at page 208 of the docket, signed by Mr. Mongane. But what Mr. Mongane says is that he is attaching exhibits, and he is attaching the SAP 83A. No mention made of the video. And if one pages through the affidavit of Mr. Mongane, what one sees are still images, pictures. And it is virtually impossible to see the actual movement of persons in those still images. Another document, is at page 180. It is submitted by Mr. Debray, and it is called a 212 statement. Then it says DVD copy of facial comparison and a photo album. So that's what he submitted, a DVD copy of a facial comparison and a photo album. So in the docket, there was no video included at all. Your Lordship knows the law on this issue. The Lordship knows the law on this issue. The state has an obligation when it submits the docket to disclose all the evidence that it will rely upon. The case in point, and I don't have to cite this to your Lordship, is Chabalala and others versus Attorney General of Transvaal and another. It's reported in 1995 to SACR 761 CC. I have a judgment that relies on Chabalala by Justice Lamont, if I may hand this up. And that is the state of S versus Crusher, where Justice Lamont outlines the obligations of the state in relation to the production of the docket. Chabalala itself is quoted in the third page of that judgment, and in the fifth page is the case of NDPP versus King. So, insofar as the state now argues in opposition to Bay, that essentially we have no prospects of success because there is clear-cut video evidence. The problem they face is that that video evidence was not in the docket, and it played no role whatsoever in the context of the trial. The Lordship also remembers that once the 112 sub 2 statement was read into the record, the prosecutor and defense counsel at the time handed up copies of photographs to your Lordship, and your Lordship refused to admit the copies of the photographs because your Lordship took the view that photographs could not just be handed up in court without any form of authentication. But insofar as the video evidence was concerned, it was never produced. That's the first problem that they face. The second one is that the video evidence does in fact exist, as the state alleges. On the first postulation, no video evidence exists, and therefore what is stated in the affidavit is false. Because if it existed, it should have been produced during the trial. And the second possibility is that the video evidence does exist, as the state alleges in its answering affidavit. But if it exists, but it was withheld from the accused, what that means is extremely serious, because it means that the accused was made to plead on the basis of incomplete facts that were deliberately withheld from him. In other words, he was misled into the Section 112 statement that he signed. Both of those outcomes do not bode well for the prosecutors, because the prosecutors, of course, must pursue justice robustly, but they also have a duty to make appropriate disclosures. They have a duty not to play fast and loose with the truth. So, it is either our learned friends are telling the truth now about the video evidence, but then they lied to your Lordship when they decided not to disclose the video evidence, or the video evidence exists, but it was withheld from the accused. If you take the first one, which there is no video evidence, then we have a much difficult problem, because they have said under oath there is video evidence. But once you enter into the second possibility, that the video evidence exists, but it was withheld, on what basis then was the accused made to sign a Section 112 statement if the contents of the docket were withheld from him? Particularly, the most crucial piece, the state identifies the video as the most crucial piece of evidence against my client. So, I'll submit on this score alone, on the mere fact that the state now in affidavit before your Lordship alleges that my client's guilt is established beyond any reasonable doubt because he's identified the video, in circumstances where that evidence was withheld before your Lordship when you confirmed the Section 112 statement, in those circumstances alone, there is a strong possibility that on appeal, this conviction will be set aside. That takes me then to why this is important for purposes of bail. Your Lordship knows what the law is from S versus Hudson, S versus Anderson. What I have to persuade your Lordship about is that I have an appeal that is reasonably likely to succeed. I don't have to show your Lordship that I will win. I don't have to show your Lordship that you were wrong. I simply have to show that there is a reasonable likelihood that this appeal may be upheld. That is the finding in S versus Hudson. The same in S versus Anderson. When I am applying for bail pending appeal, the standard is much lower. I simply have to show, according to S versus Anderson, that I have lodged the petition for appeal and that the appeal itself will not be a hopeless appeal. So, in summary, on this particular part of the argument, there is no requirement that the leave to appeal must first have been granted. It may be convenient to the state, but certainly not convenient to my client. Secondly, there is also no requirement that I must persuade your worship that I will win the appeal. As long as I can show to your lordship that the appeal that is intended to be instituted is not manifestly and obviously doomed for failure. If we stick again to the original point, the accusation that I make, that on what we now know, because the version of the state has changed considerably, their original conviction depended purely on the admission under Section 112. Now it depends on the video evidence. If that is so, and if we showed this to a judge of the High Court, he would be most astonished at the way in which the state procured the Section 112 statement. And therefore, not only do I have an appeal that is reasonably arguable, but we submit that we have an appeal that has a strong prospect of succeeding. The second point that I must make in support of the question of the likelihood of success relates to the obligations that a court ordinarily has when one deals with a Section 112 sub 2. I've shown the Lordship that the primary problem seems to have been created by the state in withholding material evidence and not including it in the docket, contrary to its constitutional obligations under S versus Shabalala. But nevertheless, your Lordship is now faced with a Section 112 statement handed to your Lordship by counsel who acted for the accused and supported apparently by the state. What does the law then require should be done in those circumstances? The law, we've cited this in full in our heads of argument, essentially requires two things. The one is that the accused should be questioned in relation to all the elements of the offense in order to make sure that the accused understands two things. One, he understands that as soon as he signs that statement, it is conclusive of the question of guilt against him. He has no second chance. The second is to satisfy the court itself that the accused, in fact, is pleading guilty to all the elements of the charge. This is the cases we have referred to. If your Lordship has a copy of our heads of argument, that's versus Kondo at paragraph 38 of our heads of argument. And S versus Kondo is important because it drew a distinction between Section 112.1b. Your Lordship knows that's where an accused is not represented and doesn't hand up a statement, and Section 112 sub 2. And where the judge says, in my view, the approach to Section 112.2 should not be any different simply because the accused is legally represented. Where the accused is unrepresented and pleads guilty to the charge, the court is required to question the accused in terms of Section 112.1b with the view of being satisfied not only that an offense was committed, but it was the accused who committed it. And then later on, the judge makes the point clear that the same approach applies to section 112 sub 2, where a statement is handed up by a legal representative on behalf of the accused. Now, I went through the record. What is clear is that as soon as my client submitted, or the statement was submitted on behalf of Mr. Cekeshe, the sole inquiry that your lordship conducted was to establish whether or not this would not be a duplication of the charges, because they appeared to be duplication, and the duplication of the convictions. Once that debate ended, your lordship went straight to judgment. It's about 8 pages of that exchange. And your lordship would be struck when you read this after 3 years of the, 2 years of the event. Your lordship asked that question, but the response that came from the accused counsel was the most incomprehensible. Because on the one hand, he suggested that it was a duplication. And then on the other hand, he suggested that it was not a duplication. And then your lordship entered judgment. But the point I will be making on appeal, and I'm trying to persuade your lordship now for purpose of leave to appeal, is that the obligation under section 112 sub 2 in this particular instance was not fulfilled, because the accused was never questioned to ascertain, as it is required in S versus Naidu and the cases that came after it, was never questioned to ascertain whether he admitted all of the elements of the offense. Never questioned to ascertain if he understood that the submission of that statement is dispositive of his guilt. There is a case that we have referred to that makes this position even clearer. It's S versus B. It's at paragraph 40 of our heads of argument. This is what the judge says in the Natal Provincial Division. Says section 112 sub 2 provides that where an accused or his legal advisor hands in a written statement by the accused in which the accused sets out the facts which he admits and upon which he has pleaded guilty, the court may, instead of questioning the accused, convict and sentence. And then it says, it is clear that this section also requires not only a series of admissions, but the facts upon which those admissions are based. In my view, the magistrate was incorrect in allowing this statement to pass without further questioning. And in my view, the conviction of the accused upon this statement and this statement alone is improper. So, the obligation is made explicit in S versus Kondo, that it's the same as 112.1b and 112.2. In S versus B, the judge makes it clear that the failure to question an accused under 112.b, specifically to direct the accused's attention to all of the elements in the charge, and then to be satisfied that he admits all of those facts, would be sufficient to set aside the conviction as an improper conviction. So, I don't have to show your lordship that your lordship was wrong. I simply have to show your lordship that there is a possibility that your lordship will be found to have been wrong. These two cases I've shown your lordship are strong indicators that on appeal, the admission of the statement in the circumstances in which it happened would most likely be found to have been an improper basis for the conviction of the accused. Now, your lordship will see the facts. They will appear in volume one of the record.
Right, we're going to come out of that. Advocate Thembeka Ngokayi Tobi presenting arguments why his client Kanya Cekeshe should be freed. As you will remember, Cekeshe has been behind bars since December 2017 after being sentenced to 5 years for public disturbance. He allegedly set fire to a police vehicle at the height of the Fees Must Fall protest in 2016. Criselda Lewis will continue to give you updates on the outcomes of that process during the day here on the SABC News channel. But from us, that's it for the day. On Point is up next. Goodbye and thanks for watching.
On Health Talk, we discuss everything from the common cold to illnesses you may not have heard of.
Fibroids are benign tumors. What that means is that they're not cancerous.
We're talking STIs, and clearly there's a lot of people out there who know, but I'm sure there's some who still don't.
We're talking about sexually transmitted infections. So these are infections transmitted between two partners,
yeah,
engaging in sexual activity.
I developed the vitiligo at the age of 5. As we went to dermatologists, they are the ones which told us that this condition is actually vitiligo.
After consuming a lot of mixtures, putting a lot of ointments, I just said it's enough.
When we deal with employee wellness, it's necessarily all of those things that, if are not attended to, would affect the company's bottom line in terms of productivity.
Watch Health Talk Saturday at 9 a.m.
The women and the children of this great country are under siege.
I can hear the cries of women in the streets.
Women are dying with protection orders in their homes.
Women face the onslaught.